Now we have not received the spirit of the world, but the spirit which is from God, that we might understand the gifts bestowed upon us by God. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, amen. This epistle in the second chapter of the first letter to the Corinthians is a continuation this week from last week. And as we mentioned to you last week, what St. Paul is communicating to us, what he desires us to understand, is this presence of the Spirit of God among us within the church. Why the icon of Pentecost remains here for this season, for these weeks at least, in order to remind us of the transformation that takes place. At the bottom of the icon, you actually see there's an old, it looks like an old man, a figure who's below in the darkness. But if you look at it, the Greek inscription actually says Chronos. This is time. In the same way that Pentecost transforms and epiphanizes, manifests the body of Christ on that day, so also it's eternity entering time in a very real personal way in the church. And therefore time, Chronos, is also transformed. This icon will echo the icon of the resurrection, in which you see the broken chains and the shackles of death and of the underworld shattered by the resurrection. So you have Chronos also coming from the darkness of a resurrection and transformation by the presence of the Spirit. Now what we also said last week is that friendship, this divine charity that God desires from us and within us, friendship in general comes from communication. We have to speak. We have to be able to communicate, otherwise love cannot be present. We don't know this person. We may work with them, but we don't know them. And so St. Paul goes even further this week with this following text by talking about the fact that with the spirit of man, each person, no one knows that person except the person, and even then we don't necessarily know ourselves very well. Life has a way of smashing us around, and those moments and circumstances make us come to realize things about ourselves that we may have not noticed before. But all the same, it's true that no one knows this person except for this person and those to whom he desires to communicate himself. And he says so it is with God. The communication of God in his divine spirit is that he desires us to know who he is. Now I mentioned to you to read this epistle, the first epistle. I would say read it in a chunk, the first four chapters. Because the first four chapters deal primarily with the divisions that are taking place in the parish at Corinth. And Corinth, as I mentioned to you, was one of the more difficult churches that St. Paul had to deal with. Totally different if you read the letter to the Philippians. Philippi, that parish, they got it. That community developed and actually had an intimate friendship with St. Paul that he did not have with other parishes. The Corinthians, namely, being one of them, with whom he did not have that same bond. So what he's trying to remind the Corinthians is the divisions that are among you is because you are not seeing and responding to the grace of God that's been given to you. You talk about external charismata, speaking in tongues, healings, prophecy. You talk about these things that come about. But they're all external to you. That's not the work of God fundamentally, which is the work of redemption and salvation. Those are things to help unbelievers come toward the mystery of the Spirit of God present. You are focused on the wrong things, he says. And so what he's doing in the first four chapters is trying to elevate the minds of these people. Because for exactly the same reason that they focus upon what God is doing externally in the community with these different gifts, they're breaking into these little cliques and breaking into these little factions within the parish. And so he's trying to elevate the whole reality up, that you do not see yourselves as being the body of Christ. And this is a problem. Which is why in these verses 12 through 16, or 11 through 16 that we have this morning, he's trying to remind us of what God is trying to accomplish within our lives, and within at an individual level, but more importantly, even in a certain sense, at the level of the community itself, the parish. In verse 14, St. Paul says that the sensual man, the non-spiritual, the sensual man does not perceive these things that are of the Spirit of God. For it is to him foolishness. So we can all read a catechism book. We can all know what the Church of Christ teaches. But to perceive it and understand it requires a level of faith and grace. We can hear the same words. We live in a culture now in which Christianity is just a punching bag. It's something to make fun of. And as a result, what St. Paul has already said originally is even the word for word you can hear what the doctrine is, but that the sensual man does not perceive it. He is incapable of understanding it because of his sensuality. Now, as I've mentioned to you before, when St. Paul uses these terms of sensual or flesh and spirit, he's not talking about spirit in the sense of the soul or of God and the flesh being something impure or sinful. What he means by the flesh, or in this case the sensual man, is the individual who lives just purely according to nature. Nothing transcendent in their life. There's no question of grace. There's no question of the Spirit of God for them. They live merely at the level of nature. They can be perfectly upright, respectful people. The man of the carnal man is not someone who is necessarily debauched and degraded. But the carnal man, all the same, cannot understand and perceive the Spirit of God. So in an indirect way, what St. Paul is telling the Corinthians is, wake up, you're carnal. You don't understand what God is actually trying to accomplish within your lives. Which is, he says, that we have received the Spirit of God so that we may appreciate these gifts which God has given to us. Remember, he's writing to people who are already all baptized. These people all have faith in theory. They believe. They're believers. But they do not perceive what God is trying to accomplish within their lives. And for this reason, they focus on the external gifts. For this reason, they break into their little coteries and their cliques. And they have division within the body of Christ. So this is hard. And when you read the writings of St. Paul, in fact, we have even from the inspired text in the letters of St. Peter, he makes reference to the fact that in our brother Paul's letters, there are places that are hard and difficult to understand. And so at some point we have within his letters this attempt to elevate our thinking. So we can finish on the public side. And then I just want to leave you with one thought considering the individual. We've just commemorated through the Great Lent, through the Great Fast, and the resurrection of our Lord in Pentecost. These great moments in which God enters time, our Lord is not received by the people as a people of Israel who were meant to receive the Messiah. Thousands of Jews, of course, received our Lord. But as a people, Israel did not budge. He's betrayed. He's tortured, put to death. And of course, there's the resurrection and transformation of Pentecost. Why does God go through all of this? Sanctification of mankind doesn't require that God die. So why does God choose to do this and manifest himself to us? If we look at the large picture, when God creates the world and things are brought into existence, let there be light, and all the rest of creation in the cosmos that's created, God is making things to exist, the fundamental level to be, that they may participate in that goodness of existence. And God communicates at that level. That carnal man can know quite a few things about God. We call it philosophy, but it's a natural knowledge, which is completely open to all of the people who exist, and to creation that exists. And God communicates at that level of existence and of nature. Which is why, by the way, St. Paul says that for the Greeks and the Romans, at the beginning of his letter to the Romans, he says that the Greeks and Romans are inexcusable for not knowing God. But God doesn't remain at that level, just simply communicate. This is at the level, as we mentioned last week, of working with someone who's pleasant, they're polite, they seem nice, but you don't know them. You wouldn't call them a friend. And that's the level then that God then personally begins to communicate with mankind through the patriarchs, through the prophets, the old law. And he's communicating because communication is that basis of friendship and of love. That if you don't know the person, you cannot love them. You may like them, they may be nice, you may work with them, but you cannot have an intimate relation with someone that you do not know. So God reveals himself through the prophets, through the patriarchs, through Moses, through the scriptures, through these words that for centuries, well over 1,500, 2,000 years, God communicates personally in order to prepare and to bring mankind to him, not just simply on the level of knowledge and of awe, but on a personal level to know who God is. And when he enters the world in time, as our Lord Jesus Christ is the Messiah born in Bethlehem, he is entering into a moment of communicating, not just simply personally, through the prophets, but to communicate personally himself in his divine Son. And that communication is meant to develop a further understanding of who God is. But as we know, that's not the end of the story. That we have this moment of Pentecost. We say in philosophy, the first in intention is the last in execution. Meaning the thing that we intend is the last thing we actually do. When we desire to be a surgeon, we have to make sure we have enough money to pay for university, go to university, do our studies, remain faithful and persevere through all of the years that it takes to finally become a surgeon. First in intention is the last in execution. And with that understanding, it's Pentecost, the moment in which God gives and forms and transforms a people in the new Israel of Pentecost, that he's giving the Spirit, the Holy Spirit, which is the personal and divine expression of eternal divine love. In other words, all of this event of our Lord's death, his resurrection, everything involved, is that ultimately he wants this revelation of divine charity and love within our lives. So that's in the large kind of cosmic picture. But as I mentioned, I want to leave you with one thought. Individually, which is what St. Paul is trying to get across to us. When we speak about entering into this friendship, every friendship costs. Every love requires investment. And they also make us vulnerable. Every time we love somebody, every time we make ourselves known to them, we become naked before them. This is essentially the story of the gospel. God makes himself naked before Israel, and Israel turns, and the Romans turn, and they put to death God upon a cross. But he chooses that because love is more important than the wounds that he receives. And so the same thing for us. When we speak about holiness, holiness means the individual person who has entered into that Spirit of God. Now, if you recall from last week, St. Paul quotes from Isaiah, and he says that eye has not seen, ear has not heard, what God has destined for those who love him. So he's telling us there is a great unknown that you have to walk into. Not only does it make us vulnerable, but he's asking us to walk into something that we do not see what this transformation will be. And I'm mentioning this not only the question of the church, but of the individual person who has the faith, who is baptized. We are each personally asked to enter into a pathway that we do not know where it's going to lead us. When we were 16, we had no idea what we would look like when we're 60. We have no idea where we would be when we were 60. And yet at 16, we live with great enthusiasm to go forward. In a few weeks' time, through the generosity of many of the parishioners and of the organization through the Knights of Columbus and that, we're going to celebrate the 30th anniversary of this wretched creature's glorious priesthood. We celebrate the priesthood, not this guy. But I can tell you that at the end of June in 1988, I could have told you no idea that 30 years later, that I would not be in the Rhone Valley among the Alps, but that I would be in the middle of Maine 3 decades later. And with everything else that took place during these 30 years of this kind of odyssey, I can also tell you that if I didn't know all the details of those 30 years, I would have been paralyzed with fear and would not have been ordained. To know all the details of our lives would freeze us in our tracks. I think most of us would agree. If we think of all the painful things that we've had to go through, and we up the ante when it's a question of holiness, because it's not just a question, we can kind of guess things that will happen in our lives. If I'm a farmer in the county, my family's been there for 3 generations, I can probably guess that I will also be here 30 years from now. So there are things in human life that we can guess. But when we put our feet onto this path of the Spirit of God working within us individually, that we can't foretell. We have no idea where it will take us. And that's why holiness is frightening, because we don't know where it will lead us. And as a result, most of us just don't enter into it. That we should pray for the desire to enter along the path that our Lord desires us to follow personally. Meaning, translate each one of our lives that have been initiated on the path of wisdom, but to go along the path that God truly wants us to be on is a hard thing. We know that our faith allows us to enter into the path of wisdom and knowledge. And all I can say that is to encourage each of us to ask for the strength of enlivening the illumination of our faith, that it enkindles our love so that we can enter in the path, because we may not know the details, but we know the end result is God and the beatific vision of the kingdom of life. But we don't know the steps in between, which is why we have the anchor of hope. And these are all the things that St. Paul is asking the Corinthians to enter into. So read these first 4 chapters. And then pray. To generously enter into the unknown by faith, which can only be done by the enlivening kindling of our charity, so that he may establish us in hope along this path. So that then verse 16, the end of this epistle today, will finally make sense. When St. Paul, he quoting again from Isaiah, "For who has known the mind of the Lord?" Who can know what God thinks? "That he may instruct him." No one knows what God intends. But St. Paul finishes in quite a consoling way to say, "But we have been given